Okay, thanks very much for the invitation. I happen to sort of be in the neighborhood anyway because we're potentially pursuing a collaboration with Thomas and for maybe bringing entanglement into space, which is something that he's thought a lot about, a lot more than we have. Okay, so in general, my titles modify a little bit, and so I think maybe a more truthful title here, So I don't want to point at that, I want to point at this, and we'll see what happens. Great, yes, okay, so I'm modifying the title a little bit. I'm not sure I'm going to talk much about profit today. It's mostly going to be fun and sort of a deeper understanding maybe of quantum nonlocality. So what I want to talk about, so I think a lot of these things are going to be maybe familiar to some or most of you in terms of things you've already looked at. And it's maybe, I'm not going to do derivations of Bell's inequalities or anything like that, but trying to give you a sense of where we are experimentally. And some new measurements that we've made, sort of testing the upper limits of quantum mechanics. So instead of testing local realism, actually maybe starting to test quantum mechanics against some other kinds of theories. And I don't know, given that there's a fair background in this, we may actually get to this last little topic of a look ahead. We'll see how it goes. So of course, I don't do any of these experiments myself anymore. At one point I used to, but now they're all done by my group, and in particular, almost everything I'm talking about today is the work of one graduate student, Brad Christensen, and we're always, of course, on the lookout for other talented people to come work with us.
So do you buy those uniforms?
Pardon?
Do you buy those uniforms for the students?
Well, you know, they don't dress like this all the time. We did have once, so in our physics department, we have a talent show every year, and I often make videos for this talent show, and last year was the 20th anniversary of it, so I got more than half the faculty out on the ice wearing suspenders and bow ties, and if you can look on our website if you want to see people who have no skating talent whatsoever trying to do things. Okay, so of course we sort of already all know what entanglement is, but I thought maybe I'd just give you an introduction to the origins of the word back from the Oxford English Dictionary. The first appearance, I think, came around 1700, where the idea of entanglement was somehow to have things mixed up together in a way that you can't separate them. And this is one of the first quotes from this fellow Burnet. And it's interesting because he's already talking about metaphysics here, and so it's kind of interesting that there's a connection. Another one is where we're somehow connecting to surroundings from which it's difficult to extract something. And so a few years later, there's another quote which is also somehow relevant to us about particles of matter cannot be broken wherever they are entangled to those that join to them. So that already seems to be sort of presaging our usage of this. Here's another one that has nothing at all to do with the rest of the talk, but it's kind of funny anyway. But I'm going to use this in the sense that Schroedinger introduced it as basically the quintessential quantum mechanical feature, the one that completely distinguishes it from classical lines of thought. So of course we know that we can sort of break quantum states up into two different categories. Either they're states that can be written if I have, say, two systems where I can write the overall wave function as a product of the two systems, or the other case is I can't do that, and that's the entangled case, and just that sort of examples that we might be familiar with. This is actually one of my favorite examples. It's that anytime I look up at a star and I'm seeing light from some atom, the light was emitted a long time ago, but it was probably emitted going mostly in all directions, and so the photon has been traveling, propagating out as a sphere for the last however many hundreds of years since it was emitted, and the atom has been recoiling in the opposite direction the whole time. And then, of course, as soon as I make a detection of that photon, somehow the atom knows to have been to jump to the location where it's really been recoiling in a particular direction, which is amazing, I guess. And then there's the Schrodinger cat example that we're more familiar with. So I wasn't exactly sure when I was invited to give a colloquium at what level this would be, so this next slide is just maybe a different way of representing a way to get entanglement where we don't actually kill cats, but it's based on a... the fact that photons have momentum, and if we hit this device, like at a carnival, you can dump the cat into a bucket of water, which is sort of like killing a cat. Or if we have a beam splitter here, then of course we have an entangled state between the direction of the photon. The photon is, in this case, reflected, and I have a dry happy cat. Or the photon is transmitted and fires this mechanism, and then I have a wet unhappy cat. Now, of course, we can, so they stay entangled, not for very long with any macroscopic object like that. So we can't even controllably entangle anything even as large as the DNA molecule yet, although certainly experiments are moving toward that. But we can certainly make entangled photons, which is, of course, why I'm here today. So if I look at this in terms of, I'll be talking a lot about exclusively about polarization entanglement today. So we could talk about either having factorable states where the two photons each have definite properties, or the entangled states, say the four canonical Bell states, written both in the linear basis and the diagonal basis, where each of the photons individually has no definite polarization. There's only the joint information that's stored between the two photons, and that's true no matter how far apart those photons may be. So we've definitely come to, associate entanglement with non-locality in the sense that these correlations, as we'll see, exceed what would be possible for any sort of a reasonable local realistic model where I can have these correlations. And I think that it's fair to say that most of us would say that in some sense entanglement and non-locality, they're really one and the same. So more entanglement would be more non-locality. I think that's an intuition that a lot of us would have, me included, until a while ago. But I'll show some examples where actually less entanglement gives a more non-local result. And that's a little bit surprising, I would say. Okay, so then the question is, how do we actually make these entangled states? And in our case, we're doing that using parametric down conversion. So I have a nonlinear crystal, and I send in high energy photons, which occasionally split into daughter photons. Not very often, only 1 out of 10 billion times, 1 out of 10 to the 10, do I get a split into the modes that we're looking at. And we have to satisfy energy conservation and momentum conservation, and that already leads to entanglement in those degrees of freedom, although I won't be talking about that today. But we've done other experiments where we can use so-called hyperentanglement, the fact that the photons are entangled in every possible degree of freedom. So in the types of crystals that we use, they're birefringent crystals, and that has a consequence in our particular case that the photons have the same polarization when they're born in one of these crystals. They share the same polarization with each other, and that polarization is perpendicular to that of the pump. So the pump is extraordinarily polarized in one of these crystals, and the two daughter photons, which are emitted on opposite sides of a cone, have orthogonal, or in this case, say, horizontal polarization if I'm driving with a vertical polarization. Okay, so they're obviously not entangled in polarization at the moment. How I can get that is using a scheme that we developed almost 20 years ago now, where I have two crystals. So in the first crystal, I'm going to get out my pairs of horizontally polarized photons. And I could, of course, rotate this entire diagram. Well, first I could just rotate my head by 90 degrees, or alternately, I'm going to rotate everything about the optic axis here. So I'll send in horizontally polarized light, and I'll have a crystal which is rotated by 90 degrees, how its optic axis is oriented. And then I will get out, in that case, two vertically polarized pairs of photons. And the key to getting entanglement is I will use two of these crystals back to back. And I don't know whether or not I'll get a conversion in the first crystal or in the second crystal. And that automatically gives me an entangled state, a polarization entangled state. Now, since this is an audience who has maybe seen some of these things before, let me just point out, it is true that I will get this maximally entangled state for any two crystals, but it's only going to be useful if the two cones are sort of exactly sitting on top of each other. So in particular, there might be extra degrees of freedom here, like spatial degrees of freedom, that would tell you whether you came from the first crystal being the outside cone, or whether you came from the second crystal being the inside cone. And it's important that we not have that, because if we had that, then there'd be other degrees of freedom that would be telling us which of the two processes occurred. So as I've drawn it, you could certainly tell actually from which crystal you came just by knowing whether you came from the internal cone or the external cone. And so the way that we get around that is that our crystals are actually quite thin. The pump beam is, say, of order a millimeter in diameter, or maybe, actually, I guess we'll be looking at things there. It's probably about 200 microns in diameter. And then this opening angle is really quite small. And so the end result of that is that these cones overlap very well with each other. And we'll see in a minute what the data shows, but we'll see that it shows that we have these really good correlations between the two photons. Okay, a couple features that we're also going to need is the fact that we can tune how much entanglement we have. So in particular, if I change the polarization of the pump so that I preferentially drive one crystal more strongly than the other one, then I can tune the weight of the two terms. And the other feature that experimentally we need has to do with the fact that this phase phi, it turns out, depends on the phase between the horizontal and vertical components of the pump coming in, because the vertical component of the pump gives this term, the horizontal component of the pump gives this term. So it depends on that. And if you have a short pulsed pump, then in these down conversion crystals themselves, those different polarization components go at different speeds. And so you end up averaging, this phase ends up depending on the frequency content of the pump. And if you average over that, then if you have a short pump that has a lot of spectral components, then that will end up effectively introducing decoherence. Okay, so it turns out you can fix that by putting in a simple, appropriately sized piece of quartz or something like that to pre-compensate the pump. And then this source works with broadband pumps and femtosecond pumps and things like that. So we definitely needed to use that in everything I'm going to be talking about today. Okay, so we know that we have good correlations. Well, one way is that if we measure a horizontally polarized photon, is the other photon horizontally polarized? And let's just say yes, that's certainly true. And similarly, if I measure vertical on one, the other one is vertical, that's also true. Not surprising, though, because that's the basis in which we're sort of creating these. What we'd also really like to show that we have entanglement, though, is I'd like to measure this in a different basis, like the diagonal basis. So the state HH plus VV looks like 45, 45 plus minus 45, minus 45. So what's done here is that I've analyzed photon number one with a 45 degree, a diagonal polarizer, and then I adjust the angle of the polarizer looking at photon number two. And if photon number one is polarized at 45, then its twin should also be polarized at 45. So I should verify, in some sense, Malus's law with a perfect cosinusoidal fringe, which I do with very high visibility. So I basically have essentially perfect quantum behavior in a very bright source. And now the question is, what can we use that for? And so what I want to talk about right now is using that for studying, asking questions about fundamental quantum mechanics. So one question you might ask, if I'm looking at these quantum correlations, is whether or not quantum mechanics is really the whole truth, or whether or not there's another way of explaining these correlations. So if I went back to the case of the single atom, which is emitting its photon in all directions, and I say there's an entanglement between the direction of the photon and the recoil direction of the atom, it certainly would be very reasonable to say, well, maybe what's really happening is that we don't know which direction the photon's going or which way the atom's recoiling, but really it is definitely going, it's definitely propagating in a certain direction, and the atom is recoiling in a certain direction, and we're just sort of revealing what that direction is at the end. So that would be a hidden variable model that would describe that, where there would be some notion of reality that I would say would be very comforting to us as classical beings, that that would be the way to understand things. Or even in a more basic sense, when we learn about basic quantum mechanics of an electron around a nucleus, and we say the electron is in this cloud around the nucleus, you might think, well, really the electron is in a definite location, and we're just revealing what that is, not that it's really everywhere around the nucleus. Okay, so this is the sort of element of reality that Einstein wanted to impose upon quantum mechanics. And so they want to, along with his collaborators, Podolsky and Rosen, they looked at the case where they were trying to understand, is there a different way that we can understand some of these results? And so they wanted to say that these correlations are really due to some extra element of reality that we don't have access to. So something that's beyond quantum mechanics. They didn't use the term local hidden variable, but that's basically what they were referring to. And so the notion that they wanted what nature to hold to was that they wanted to have some sense of realism, which is that there'd be some reality that it would exist whether or not we were actually measuring that at the time. And the second notion, of course, very dear to Einstein, was that of locality, which is that if we change something on one system or we make a measurement on one system, it shouldn't have a detectable influence at some other non-interacting system. So we can enforce that experimentally by having a space-like separation between the systems. And mathematically, this locality condition is saying that the probability, given a particular lambda is supposed to represent this hidden variable of our system, and given measurements, choices A and B on the two sides, A and B, and given measurement outcomes, capital A and capital B, the locality constraint is that this joint probability of getting two particular outcomes given two particular measurements should factorize into something that only depends on system A times something that only depends on system B. Okay, and for a while, it was, of course, believed in some sense that it was a philosophical choice whether or not you trusted quantum mechanics or whether you trusted this sort of local realistic model, because for the next 30 years after they said this, it seemed like those were just two different interpretations or two different philosophical perspectives. It didn't seem like they were different in any way. But then 50 years ago, John Bell showed that, in fact, quantum mechanics gives different statistical properties or predictions than any local realistic model. And he wrote down a Bell inequality that's looking at combinations of correlation measurements between the two sides. So I've got the two party, the photons or particles are going off the two parties. They're going to randomly choose to measure in, say, on the left side, either measurement A or A prime, and on the right-hand side, either measurement B or B prime, do that at random. And we can look at these correlation coefficients, which is basically sums of coincidences, and define this Bell parameter or Bell measurement, which is a combination of three of them, one of which has a minus sign. And what Bell showed is that then these combinations, this Bell parameter is bounded by two for any local realistic model, and yet quantum mechanics predicts that it's possible to go up to the value of two times the square root of two. Okay, so there's an actual difference between these. And there have been now lots of tests in different systems. In photons, certainly lots of tests, and in atoms, and in ions, and superconducting qubits and such. And to some extent, they have agreed with quantum mechanics and have disproved this local realistic model, local hidden variable model. But in fact, every experiment to date has had at least one loophole. Most experiments have had two or three loopholes, but every experiment has had at least one. So that's what I want to talk about, trying to get rid of those loopholes. And we'll see that non-maximal entanglement in the photon case can be helpful. Okay, so I'm going to break the loopholes down into two different sort of categories. One of them has to do with locality. So the issue is that if I'm measuring my two entangled particles, my two photons, and they are not the measurement choices and the measurements themselves are not space-like separated, then it would be possible, let's say I've done a system like this, it'd be possible for information from this measurement to causally influence what was going to happen to measurement of the other particle. And so then there'd be no way to physically enforce the fact that there was, that any correlations that we saw would have to be non-local in that case. So in order to do this, we need to, in order to avoid this, we need to have very fast selection of the analyzer settings. So choosing whether we're measuring in one basis or another basis here has to be done very quickly. And that was certainly done in experiments by Alain Aspect back in the early 1980s. But there's another thing that needs to happen, which is that those need to be made randomly. So in Aspect's experiment, they just periodically switched from A, A prime, A, A prime, A prime, and it was always done periodic, and so you could really predict a second in advance what the settings would be, and therefore it's easy to come up with a hidden variable model, a set of instructions that the photons would carry with them when they left that would tell them how they could behave in such a way that they could violate a Bell inequality. So one has to have random selection of the bases as well, and that was first done in an experiment in 1998 by Gregor Weiss, and also Thomas Jennewein was one of the key people on that experiment. There's a sort of a related, what I would say a related loophole called the freedom of choice loophole, which is that whatever I'm using to choose the basis here, whatever random number generator I'm using to choose the basis, it shouldn't be able to get information back to the source, or vice versa. The source shouldn't be able to send information to the random number generator to influence what basis measurements are going to be used. So basically, keeping everything space-like separated solves all this, and that was done in another experiment by Anton Zeilinger's group about 5 years ago. Okay, so the other main loophole that has existed in experiments is the so-called detection loophole, which is sometimes related to the, which is associated with the fair sampling assumption. And the issue is that if we have a low detection efficiency, it's possible that although we observe a violation of Bell's inequalities on the sub-ensemble that we detect, if we were to detect more of the entire ensemble, we wouldn't get a violation. In a sense, it's a lot like if you're doing polls for elections, if they only poll 10% of the people, even though, let's say one candidate had unanimously, every one of those 10% of the people voted for candidate A, it's still possible that candidate A lost because it's possible that the other 90% of the people that weren't polled all voted for candidate B. So in polling, what we do is we make the assumption that we've done a random, a fair sample of the people who are coming out of the elections. But if we really want to have an ironclad proof, you really would need to measure in the case of the election, I guess if you measure 51% of the people, then the 49 that you don't measure aren't enough to sort of sway the results. I guess it depends exactly how close they are. But okay, so in the case of Bell's inequalities, one needs to have an efficiency that's greater than about 83%. That's if you're using maximally entangled states. It turns out you can't use atomic systems like the original aspect experiment, actually absolutely cannot close the detection loophole. And the reason to see that is that in the aspect experiment, they have the entangled photons come from a two-photon decay in an atom. So the two photons, if they go off back to back, have perfect polarization correlations, and that's great. That's what they use. They select the ones that go off back to back. But the photons don't have to go off back to back. They could also go off at 90 degrees to each other, and the atom that emits them could recoil in a way that conserves momentum. And it was shown in this paper by Marshall and Santos and Celery that, in fact, if you were to collect all of the photons, then collecting the ones that went off, say, at this angle, those wouldn't have strong enough polarization correlations to violate a Bell inequality. So in fact, not only is the fair sampling assumption somewhat dubious in those atomic cascade experiments, in fact, it's completely wrong because the photons that they collect, they're not a fair sample at all. They're absolutely a sample that's guaranteed to give you a violation, whereas if you were to collect everything, you absolutely wouldn't get a violation. So it's a problem. Okay, so experiments have been done, though, that have closed the detection loophole. They've been done with ions, although probably not in this first experiment, but in a slightly later experiment. I could talk to people about that later if you want. With superconducting qubits, coupling between an atom and a photon with Harold Weinfurter's group. And then a couple years ago, two groups, my own group and that of Anton Zeilinger's group, finally managed to close the detection loophole with photons. So to understand where the efficiency requirements come in, I'm going to discuss a type of Bell inequality, the Clauser-Horn inequality. And the reason we want to do that, it's one that directly compares coincidence rates and singles rates, and you'll be able to see exactly where the detector efficiency plays in. So this is what the Clauser-Horn inequality looks like. For any local realistic theory, this combination of four coincidence rates should be less than this combination of two singles rates. we can convert this into something that we could measure. Let's call it the Bell parameter. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to subtract these two singles probabilities, and then I'll convert all the probabilities into things that we actually measure by taking, for example, the probability of this coincidence detection when the analyzers are set at A and B is given by the number of coincidences that we saw when the analyzers were set at A and B divided by the number of times we tried to make the measurement where the analyzers were set at A and B. So we can normalize everything in that way. So these are all things that we can now measure. And for any local realistic model, this B should be less than or equal to 0. And of course, this wouldn't be interesting if we couldn't get a violation of that in quantum mechanics. And quantum mechanics predicts a maximum violation of 0.207. OK, let's see where the detector efficiencies come in. We can see that these coincidence rates, since I have to detect both photons, always depend on the square of the detector efficiency eta, because I have to detect both photons. So the whole left-hand side here all goes as eta squared. On the other hand, these singles detections, these single probabilities, they only depend on eta. So if eta is very small, then, so remember, we're trying to show that this left-hand side is bigger than the right-hand side. That would be the quantum mechanical violation of this. But if eta is small, then we're never going to see that, because the left-hand side goes as eta squared and the right-hand side goes as eta. So in fact, you can never get a violation unless the efficiency is greater than 83%. However, it turns out, it was shown by Philippe Eberhard quite a while ago, that if you use a non-Maxley entangled state, then you can push the efficiency down to 67% in the limit of having no background. And sort of the intuitive way to see that, you want these, I'm trying to have these counts or these probabilities to be small to account for the fact that the efficiency is maybe not as big as I would like them. And I can get rid of those, I could reduce those, I should say, if I have something where, for example, the HH term is much less than the VV term. So this looks like it's almost vertically polarized. So I can choose my settings A and B very close to horizontal that will basically block out all of those singles counts. So that will be a way of really suppressing these singles probabilities. And yet I have enough flexibility in choosing A prime and B prime that I can still get a violation on the left-hand side. OK, so the point is I want to use a non-Maxley entangled state. And this is maybe our first indication that somehow weak entanglement can look more non-local than strong entanglement. So the source that we used for this experiment, we have a frequency tripled neodymium YAG laser. It's operating, it's a pulse laser operating at 120 megahertz with 5 picosecond pulses. We have this double crystal source. With Bebo crystals, we have the temporal compensation that I mentioned that's important with these 5 picosecond pulses. And then one of the photons is directed to one player, the other to another player. They're analyzed in this case using Brewster angle polarizing beam splitters, which have very low loss and have very high extinction ratio. And we're setting the basis at the moment just using some halfway plates that we rotate from one place, one orientation to another. That's important for us because, again, those are very low loss. Remember, loss is the whole thing that we're trying to get around in this case. And then at the end, we detect them using, we collect into single mode fibers, and those are directed to some transition edge superconducting detectors. So we make states that are very non-Maxley entangled. So the probability of the HH term compared to the VV term is reduced by about a factor of 0.26 squared, so it's quite unbalanced. And this is just showing that even though we're quite non-maximally entangled, we still get high visibility in all the bases that we're using. So that's also going to be important. So the detectors are really one of the main technologies that has enabled these experiments to become possible in a way that wasn't possible 15 years ago. And so we were collaborating with the Sewu Nam's group from NIST using these transition edge superconducting detectors. Basically, it's a small piece of superconductor which is biased right at the threshold between when it's completely superconducting and when it's not superconducting. It's sitting right on the edge. And a photon comes in, the photon is absorbed, that heats the material up a little bit, and therefore, as the temperature goes up slightly, the resistance changes in a measurable way, and that can be detected at the single photon level. I apologize that this curve is very hard to see the actual curves on here, but basically this is a theoretical calculation putting different stacks of dielectric materials on top to improve the absorption in the superconducting material. It doesn't really matter what the curves look like, just look at the, it's going from an absorption probability from 98% to 100%. And so basically we're able to get very high absorption in these materials. We think that in our particular case we had efficiency of approximately 96% for the photons. The photons that we're using, and these are photons at it actually doesn't say here, but these are photons at 710 nanometers that we're detecting. So we didn't have these detectors. We had to borrow them from NIST, and they were brought to us by Aaron Miller, who was kind enough to bring the huge Dewar that they come with. And I noted that he bears a strong resemblance to this action hero Jason Statham, who has been in many movies about the transporter, so it's somehow very appropriate. We also noticed that somehow the other NIST people all share a similar characteristic, and I'm a little worried if I keep working with these detectors for a while that similar things will happen to me. So quick puzzle here, when is a transition edge superconducting device not a single photon detector? And the answer is when it's a cell phone. So it turns out that these devices are very sensitive to background electromagnetic radiation. And where we were doing our experiment was above undergraduate labs, where a lot of undergraduates had their cell phones, which kept trying to ping the network. And they would produce signals that are distinguishable from the single photon signals, but not without doing a lot of extra processing. And you really don't want to have to go in and by hand remove data from your data stream, because then you might be somehow cheating yourself. So instead, we had to go around and tell all the undergraduates to turn off their cell phones so that we could actually get a result. Okay, so do we have a result? The answer is yes. We do have a violation of the Clauser-Horn inequality. So remember, this is what we're trying to show. Local realism would say that this should be less than or equal to zero, and we have a value which is greater than zero, not a lot greater than zero, but greater enough to have a violation. It's helpful to rewrite the inequality a slightly different way. So the way that I got this one was that I took all these, the original one, Clauser-Horn, had the four coincidence probabilities were less than the sum of the two singles probabilities, and then all I did to get this was I subtracted them. The other thing I could do is I could take these four coincidence probabilities, which were originally less than the sum of the two singles probabilities, and I could divide by the two singles probabilities. And so then the inequality says that for any local realistic model, this combination should be less than one. And so we get a value of something which is slightly greater than one. The reason why it's useful to write in this way is that we see that the numerator here varies as the efficiency squared, and the denominator varies as the efficiency. Yes, so the whole thing is proportional to the efficiency. So to the extent that we have 1.015, that means that we have an efficiency overhead in our experiment of about 1.5%. Yeah, so if our efficiency in our experiment had been 1.6% lower, then we wouldn't have had a violation. So that tells us how much overhead we have if we're going to try to do an experiment that would close not only the detection loophole, but also the locality loophole as well. So that's what we would like to do now. We'd like to close all loopholes in a single experiment, which has not been done by any system yet, because it's interesting, because it enables interesting applications in terms of device-independent quantum communication, and also because we've been at this for such a long time, it really seems a shame that we don't yet have a loophole-free test. So unfortunately, that's a little bit more complicated because we have to go to this longer distance, and we have to do that. At the moment, if we use the source as we have it, we only have 1.5% overhead, and going an extra 500 feet or something like that and the fact that we have to do active switching. So we can no longer use halfway plates that were rotating very slowly. Instead, we need to have a Pockel cell, and the Pockel cells tend to have a loss of maybe something like 1% if you get a really pretty good one. So now our 1.5% margin has just gone down to 0.5% margin, and that's not even accounting for the fact that we have to go this longer distance. Okay, so there are some things that we can do to try to improve that. So one thing is that we were doing everything in through fiber optic, and it might be possible to go in free space. We've previously done experiments in my lab where we saw free space coupling of up to 99%. So in other words, if I see one photon, I catch its other photon with a 99% probability. In the fiber experiment that we were just doing, that we already did, that number was like 90%. So that would give us a pretty big boost. But there's still a lot of other technologies that, a lot of things that really need to be tweaked up. We're working on this. Anton Zeilinger's group is working on this. People at NIST are working on this. There's a number of people around the world who are trying to do a completely loophole-free test. And I guess I'd be surprised if a year and a half from now, there weren't at least one or two groups that had this. I'd be even more surprised if they didn't get a violation. Although, of course, when you first do the experiment, that's probably what happens till you fix whatever problem is coming. Okay, so everything I've been talking about so far actually had nothing at all to do with quantum mechanics. It only had to do with disproving this other interpretation of correlations, this local realistic model. But it'd be interesting to see if we could start testing the upper limits, start testing the quantum mechanics itself to see, well, to see is the quantum mechanics the correct description of what's going on. So I've showed previously that we have these extremely high visibility fringes, and in fact we can use that in an experiment to see how close can we get to the quantum mechanical maximum, this 2 root 2 that we expect. And in an experiment that was done to optimize that, not with high efficiency and not closing the other loophole, but just to see in a controlled experiment how close can we get to 2 root 2, in fact we get really very close to it. As far as I know, this is the closest test of the upper limit of quantum mechanics. So there's been a lot of interest recently in generalized tests of nonlocality. So not necessarily just tests of quantum mechanics, but some generalized theory of nonlocality. So we want to limit ourselves to theories, correlations that satisfy no signaling. So consistent with relativity. So in other words, I want a system where I can do something on this side, and maybe there's some spooky quantum action at a distance on the other side, but not in such a way that I can send signals with that. And it turns out that it is possible physically, well, physically, it's possible mathematically, I should say, that you can have correlations that are stronger than those realizable by quantum theory. So the model that we have here is I've got two parties. They're connected maybe by some entangled state or some sort of state that's allowing them to have correlations. They're going to choose what kind of measurement settings X and Y they're going to make, and then they'll get outcomes A and B. And so we can then look at what are the constraints given that we want outcome on this side B not to depend in any communicable way on what's happening on the other side. And that gives a so-called entanglement polytope, which we can break up our space into sort of three pieces. It's a little bit bad that these aren't quite overlapping, which they should be. Sorry about that. So there's what locality would predict, and then quantum mechanics has stronger correlations than local realistic models could have. And then on the outside, there's also some cases where you could have non-signaling correlations, which are stronger than quantum mechanics. And one could look at that with a different sort of non-locality test. So I'll show a couple examples here. So one, this was the so-called CHSH inequality that we've been talking about, where some of these correlation coefficients is supposed to be less than 2. And if you change the minus sign from the 2-2 term to the 1-1 term, you get another inequality, which is also supposed to be less than 2. And one can show that there's a generalized inequality that a combination of these two has to be according to quantum. So these are constraints on local realistic models, that this value of S has to be less than or equal to 2. One can then also show a constraint on quantum correlations, that according to quantum correlations, this particular combination of these two has to be less than 2 root 2, the quantum mechanical upper bound. And so this is a plot on the two axes of this inequality, the SCHSH, and this other symmetrized, or what will I say, slightly different version of that. And the square box is what you would get from any local realistic model. The circle, there's a green circle that you can probably barely see here, is what quantum mechanics would predict. The rectangle here is what's showing what any no signaling theory would allow. So in principle, you could have correlations that were stronger than quantum mechanics. And the black dots here are the 180 data points that were taken. And then here I've shown the value of the maximum value predicted according to quantum mechanics minus the what we've actually measured. And I guess the bottom line is the sum of our 180 measurements, the average of those, is in very good agreement with the quantum mechanical maximum and not exceeding it in any way. There's another inequality that one could study, so-called tilted Bell inequality, which is comparing these coincidence probabilities to singles probabilities with some controllable parameter tau, where tau has to range from 1 to 3/2, and where this, according to any local realistic models, should be less than or equal to 0. So when tau is equal to 1, this is just the Clauser-Horn inequality that we've already seen, which has a maximum value of 0.207. So I'm plotting here this S of tau versus tau. It turns out that when tau is greater than 1, you get a bigger violation of this inequality if you use a non-maximally entangled state than if you use a maximally entangled state. And it turns out that if tau is greater than 1.207, then in fact, a maximally entangled state doesn't give any violation of the inequality whatsoever. So you can have a maximally entangled state, and it won't give you any violation showing that local realism is a bad model. And in some sense, that's what's being shown here. So here's tau. If we're below 1 point, if we're at 1, then here's the quantum mechanical maximum that we expect. Here's the local bound. And as I increase tau, the local bound always stays at 0. The maximally entangled, what you can get from a maximally entangled state just drops. And if it's tau is greater than 1.2, then you can't get any violation. And what we have by using a non-maximally entangled state is that we're able to get violations. And there's a number of cases where we have violations in regions where there'd be no possibility of any violation with a maximally entangled state. Okay, so this is another example of a case where we have more non-locality even though there's less entanglement. And there's a paper on this that I may have appeared on the archive today. If not today, then certainly tomorrow. Okay, so what's left to be done? We'd of course like to do a completely loophole-free test. Interesting, so we're doing experiments with photons, but of course it's also interesting to do tests with massive systems instead. Photons are in some sense intrinsically relativistic, and one could conceive of being able to violate a Bell inequality with photons and not with massive systems, or vice versa. One could just conceive that they could behave differently, so it's important to test them separately, I would say. We'd also like to pursue tests in larger Hilbert spaces involving more particles or other degrees of freedom, or not just, say, a two-value system like polarization, but you could use time bins or spatial modes to look at much larger spaces. Also, it's interesting to consider moving to much larger distances, and that's one of the reasons that we're here, is thinking about possibly doing tests either to or from outer space. In that case, then, one, you can test, does the entanglement actually survive over very long distances? Of course, according to quantum mechanics, it does, but one should actually do tests of things like this. And also, if we have moving platforms, they can start to be moving at speeds that are relativistically relevant. So we could start potentially seeing differences that would take into account special relativity, as an example, or even general relativity if things are done at different altitudes. Something that we're moving toward is being able to hopefully do tests with human observers. And finally, there's a lot of applications that are now being looked at for device-independent quantum communication, cryptography, random number generation, and so on. And I think one of the open theoretical questions is trying to understand what are the implications of the fact that sometimes partial entanglement appears more non-local? Are there ways of using that in applications for quantum key distribution or other sort of quantum communication protocols in a way that that would make those sort of states preferable over maximally entangled states? Okay, so I think the last thing I want to do is just give a quick lesson in quantum cooking, just because I described it in my abstract. So this is just another way of thinking about why quantum mechanics is weird or why Bell inequalities are strange. Again, I haven't really derived a Bell inequality, but you know, has everyone here actually like derived Bell inequalities or seen it or something like that? So I always had the sense that maybe there are a lot of steps that go into it, right? It's not just like two steps. There's quite a few steps, and there's always the sense that maybe somehow I missed something in one of the steps and that's why I can get this weird result. So Lucian Hardy had come up with an example that showed the inconsistency of quantum mechanics and local realism, but without needing an inequality. And we were at a conference together, and it was a philosophy conference, and he came up with this example that involved cats and dogs with teeth and no teeth, and it was very confusing. So we thought we could maybe come up with an easier to explain example, and this is my favorite example if I'm trying to explain to lay people, which isn't you, but maybe someday you're talking to lay people and you want to understand, explain why quantum mechanics is weird. So the idea is that I have a kitchen, and the kitchen has doors, and out of the doors come conveyor belts, and there are ovens, pairs of ovens going to the left and to the right, and there's two players, one on the left, one on the right, Lucy on the left and Ricardo on the right, and there are two types of measurements that they can make. They can either wait till the oven gets all the way to the end, open it and see does the cake, which is in, they find out there's a cake, does the cake taste good or not taste good? That's one type of measurement they can make. Or they can make a measurement in the middle and see whether the batter of the cake has risen by that middle stage. Yeah? These are maybe like a souffle of some kind, so when they close the oven door again, everything collapses and tastes totally terrible. So you can only make one of the two types of measurements. So the whole trick in coming up with an example here is coming up with something that has non-commuting observables. Now, of course, rotations are also non-commuting observables, but even physicists have to sort of sit there with a book to convince themselves that they don't commute. So this is a simpler way of, or I think, a simpler example of a non-commuting observable. So I'm just going to tell you the results of the measurements. They're randomly going to individually decide to measure at the end or in the middle, and I'll just tell you what the results are. So sometimes, up to about 9% of the time, in the cases where they both measured in the middle, sometimes 9%, both the cakes rose early. Maybe only one cake rose early some of the time, or maybe neither one, but 9% of the time, both cakes rise early. They see that when Lucy made the measurement in the middle and Ricardo did the taste test at the end, it was always the case that if her cake rose early, then his cake tasted good, and vice versa. If he measured in the middle and he saw that his cake rose early, when they compared their data, they found in those cases, her cake always tasted good. It might have been that her cake would have tasted good even if his cake didn't rise early, but there's definitely a perfect correlation in this case. And that leads us to hypothesize that there's some correlation in the history of the cakes. They're made from the same batter, they come from the same chef. In our case, they're made from the same entanglement source or something like that. Okay, so now the question is, if they both do the taste test on their cakes, on the basis of these three facts, 1, 2, and 2 prime, what can we conclude if they both do the taste test? And this is the audience participation part of our show. Pardon? Sometimes they both taste good, and how many times? At least 9%, right? It could even be more than 9%. But since 9% both rise early, and whenever one rises early, the other one tastes good, the expectation has to be that at least 9% of the time both will taste good. And the problem is that quantum mechanically, we can make a state where both never taste good simultaneously. One can taste good, but they will both never taste good simultaneously. That state looks like this. It's a non-maximally entangled combination of bad and good cakes. But you notice there's no good-good term. That's the main thing. So you never get them both tasting good. So we can't, of course, do the experiment with cakes, but we can do it with polarization of photons. So we can associate horizontal and vertical polarization with good and bad. And we can associate risen and not risen with these particular angles, minus 51 and 39. Those are chosen to maximize that 9% number. Now, if I go back just a second, that 9% that we got, that was equal to the 9% of risen early cases. And that's assuming the fact that whenever one rose early, the other one tasted good. If sometimes when one rose early, the other one tasted bad, that would reduce our expectation of how many good goods we have. So in fact, I can convert this 9% can be reduced by however many risen bads and bad risens we have. So I actually do end up experimentally with an inequality. And if I just reorder this a little bit, the number of good goods and risen bads and bad risens for any local realistic theory, our intuitive notion, should be greater than the number of risen risens. And when we do the experiment with our tweaked up source, we get this number 16,000, which is obviously not less than 255. And of course, the problem in our logic came in the implicit assumption that when I get a result on one side, it doesn't affect what the result on the other side is going to be, and yet we know quantum mechanically that's not the case. Getting a particular result on this side does have an influence on what the result on the other side is going to be, never in a way that I can send signals, but nevertheless, it does show up as a correlation. Okay, so just in summary of the things that I've talked about today, photons are now the only physical system to have closed all the loopholes, trying to close all of them simultaneously. So all the loopholes independently, trying to close them all at once is still a challenge. We can use these generalized tests of nonlocality to start studying ultra quantum theories, like so-called PR boxes, Popescu-Rorlich boxes. And I didn't talk about those, but we've done quite a bit of measurements on those. And at the moment, I guess I'd say there's not really any evidence of any ultra quantum theory. We've seen that weaker entanglement can lead to greater non-local effects, which is interesting. And a number of applications that people can look at now, and wishful thinking of where we might eventually go with this. So I think I will end with a very nice quote from Einstein. This is not really him balancing on the top of the mountain, but okay, thanks very much.